Hello, I welcome you all to a discussion named as Magic, Witchcraft, Ritual and Healing. I have primarily divided my lecture into 9 main sections. They are, firstly, I will be exploring the meanings of magic, spell, ritual and witchcraft. I will then move on to the second section of my lecture, which will be dealing with the sociologist's opinion on the use of magic in society. Thirdly, I will try to focus on the history of witchcraft. In the fourth section, I will try to shed light on the tools of witchcraft. Fifthly, I will try to direct your attention to the different types of magic that are present in the society for the healing of members. Sixthly, I will speak on the various tools of magic which are meant for healing the members of the society. Seventhly, I will discuss on the basic rituals of magic for healing. Eighthly, I will speak on the stages of magic to achieve healing. And finally, in the final section, that is the 9th section, I will discuss on the use of plants and herbs as magical tools of healing, which will be followed by a conclusion. Michael D. Belli, in his article named as The Meanings of Magic, noted that magic might be said to comprise or at least describe a system for comprehending the entire world. It provides a means for navigating among the varied forces that comprise and shape material creation and promises its practitioners methods of controlling or at least affecting those forces. In certain circumstances, magicians claim that their rites can elevate them to the higher state of consciousness, allowing them to perceive occult aspects of nature or enter into communion with prenatural or supernatural entities. Magic has often been linked to other expansive systems for understanding, interacting with, and influencing the whole of creation, namely religion and science. A remarkable aspect of magic is the degree to which many people in various social and historical contexts have engaged in acts that their culture as a whole, or at least certain cultural authorities, would categorize as magical without considering themselves to be performing magic. Magic is referred as a supernatural method by which people can bring about particular outcomes of their choice. It is the magician with the help of whom the magic is performed. Magic is different from sorcery. A sorcerer is such an individual whose activities are performed in a secret way for his or her clients. A sorcerer is generally considered as an evil figure in the society. The term magic, derived from magia, a Greek word which is derived from magoi. Magoi were considered to be the Persian priest who devoted their life in the study of astrology and divination. The concept of magic started in the society when people were unable to understand the forces of nature and the causes of disease and death. As people couldn't apprehend their own future, that led them to believe in the concept of magic in the society. The origin of magic has no particular region. It was believed that ancient Egypt is the main point of magic's origin. It was believed by the people of ancient Egypt that the sun god Ra died in the western sky every night and spent hours of darkness in the underworld. It was believed that Ra was magically reborn every morning in the western sky. In ancient Egypt, magic was termed as haik, that meant things which were performed at special occasions in order to carry out specific purposes. The Oxford English Dictionary defines magic as the art that by use of spells supposedly invokes supernatural powers to influence events. Sorcery, the practice of this art. And it defines a spell as a verbal formula considered as having magical force. Any influence that can control the mind or character. Cassandra Isson opined in her book, A Practical Guide to Witchcraft and Magic Spells, that spell tends to be the term used for the less formal folk magic that, unlike ceremonial magic, is not so rigid about such things as circle casting and the use of specific tools, though it may be based in forms and use words that date back hundreds of years. Spell is not as rigid as the process involved in ceremonial magic. Many individuals use spiritual spells by which they tend to change a situation in their favor. Michael D. Belli noted that witchcraft is generally taken to mean harmful magic performed by people by low social status. It is typically not a learned craft involving long study or highly developed ritual expertise. It often carries the implication of close alliance with or worship of evil supernatural entities. Its practitioners are more often women than men, although not necessarily so. Witchcraft is a phenomenon or a construction that has appeared in many cultures. In late medieval and early modern Europe, however, authorities came to consider the practitioners of such magic to be the members of large, organized, explicitly diabolical cults. Witches offered service and worshipped the Christian devil and often explicitly exchanged their souls for the ability to command demons and so perform magical acts. In this context, witchcraft represented the culmination of centuries of linkage drawn by Christian authorities between the performance of magic and demonic forces. He mentioned that witchcraft needs to be situated in particular social and cultural milieus, and certainly the ways in which particular societies conceived and employed witchcraft as a category of magical action must be analyzed and understood. Traditionally, many countries used to follow the tradition of witch hunt. In Germany, suspect witches were made to sit on the witch's chair, a metal seat below which a fire was lit. In Scotland, confessions were forced out of suspects by an instrument called the boots, which crushed the ligaments and beaten them together and made the bones and flesh so bruised that the blood and marrow spewed forth in great abundance. In Scotland, suspect witches were pricked for the devil's mark, a spot where no pain was felt. If such a spot was found, it marked the place where the devil had consummated a pact with the accused. In 1954, Gerald Gardner published Witchcraft Today, in which he advocated the use of old, long-established rituals and introduced many of his own devising. Gardner venerated the goddess and women in general. He believed in the power of nature and that men and women could tune into it to alter the course of things. Gardner's work has, according to several anthropologists, three direct links to ancient paganism: the use of high magic, the use of plants and herbs in spells, and the involvement of folk rites and customs to manipulate the powers of nature. Gardner's work led to the revival in interest of the traditions of witchcraft, not just in Britain, and he is credited by many as being the founder of what has become an officially recognized new religion, Wicca. Wicca honors the god and the goddesses. Their names vary from group to group, as the two main deities and followers worship them in their rites and rituals. William G. Gray, in his book Magical Ritual Method, stated that ritual is not entirely a single type of activity, but comprises quite a number of separate abilities and factors conjoined for an overall reason. A ritualist must be a creative artist in a number of fields, each needing its own skill and practice. Anyone adhering to the old tradition of man making their own magical workings would need some abilities in the following: literature, languages, poetry, drama, metalwork, woodwork, needlework, painting, designing, music, dancing, elementary chemistry, floristry, plus any other skill that might have a bearing on the ritual's work. Additionally, of course, many personal qualities would be essential, such as creative imagination, patience, good humor, insight, determination, physical stamina, sound health, and indeed the entire gamut of worthwhile human potentialities. Nothing less will achieve any magical success worth having. If for no other reason, magic is well worth practicing for the sake of its valuable effects on the practitioner. Thus, magic, witchcraft, spells as well as rituals are carried out in the society since time unknown. These traditional methods to bring about particular results are still sought by the people in the 21st century. People who suffer from numerous health hazards are seeking these ways of magic, witchcraft, spells so that they can be healed from their pathological condition and can have a blissful life ahead. Rebecca L. Stein Frankel, in her book named Anthropology of Religion, Magic and Witchcraft, noted that early anthropologists were quite ethnocentric when it came to the study of magic. Edward Tyler, who discussed magic in his book Primitive Cultures, published in 1871, wrote that magic is a logical way of thinking. The problem is that the logic is based on bad premises. Tyler believed that in tribal cultures, the magician takes the same approach as a scientist, but the magician makes a mistake because he assumes a causal relationship that does not exist simply because things appear to be similar. In addition, Tyler did not include magic in the realm of religion because no spirits are involved, which he considered necessary for his definition of religion. Today, anthropologists consider magic to be religious because it is associated with supernatural mechanisms. But this has not always been the case. Earlier anthropologists and some contemporary ones see magic as a separate category from religion. James Frazer, like Tyler, believed that magic was a pseudoscience based on direct action. Frazer was a part of the evolutionary school and thought that magic was an early stage that would be replaced by religion. Religion was seen as different from magic because it is based on persuasion of supernatural beings rather than manipulation of supernatural forces. Some evolutionary school thinkers believed that ultimately religion itself would give way to science. Of course, none of this has happened. In most societies, magic, religion, and science coexist. Emile Durkheim also thought that magic could be distinguished from religion, but he focused on the social context. Unlike religious rituals that tend to involve the whole of the community, magic is often centered on the needs and desires of an individual. A farmer wants rain, a young man wants a wife, a woman needs a cure for her illness. In contrast to religious rituals that are carried out for the good of the community, magic is directed at very practical ends as articulated by an individual. Another related difference is seen in the purpose of the magic or religious ritual. Religion is seen as an end in itself. Malinowski wrote, "While in the magical act the underlying idea and aim is always clear, straightforward and definite, in the religious ceremony there is no purpose directed towards a subsequent event. Some non-magical rituals certainly have very specific goals, coming of age ceremonies, for example, but many rituals are more generalized, especially social rites of intensification. Thus, different theorists opined in their own way the use of magic in the society. The prime point which is highlighted among all the theorist words is that magic is a private affair, concerning only that individual who is involved in it. It satisfies individual desires and wants, which are thought to be fulfilled by following the rituals related to magic." Cassandra Eason noted that witchcraft probably originated about 25,000 years ago in the Paleolithic era. At that time, humankind and nature were seen as inextricably linked. People acknowledged every rock, tree, and stream as deities in the life force and the earth as mother, offering both womb and tomb. Early man used sympathetic or attracting magic in the form of dances, chants, and cave paintings of animals to attract the herds of animals that provided for the needs of the group and to bring fertility to humans and animals alike. Hunters would reenact the successful outcome of a hunt and would carry these energies into the everyday world. Offerings were made to the mistress of the herds and later the horned god, who was depicted wearing horns or antlers to display his sovereignty over the herds. Animal bones would be buried so that they, like humankind, would enjoy rebirth from the earth mother's womb. One of the earliest recorded examples of shamanism is the dancing sorcerer, painted in black on the cave walls of Les Trois Freres in the French Pyrenees. This shamanic figure, which portrays a man in animal skins, dates from about 14,000 BC and stands high above the animals that are depicted on the lower walls. Only his feet are human and he possesses the large round eyes of an owl, the antlers and ears of a stag, the front paws of a lion or bear, the genitals of a wild cat, and the tail of a horse or wolf. The Neolithic period saw the development of shrines to the triple goddess, who became associated with the three phases of the moon, waxing, full, and waning. The moon provided one of the earliest ways by which people calculated time. The full moon was also associated in later ages with romance and passions, originally because this coincided with peak female fertility. Moon magic for the increase of love and fertility is still practiced under the auspices of the waxing moon. It was not until about 3,000 years ago that the male role in conception was fully understood in the West, and only then were the sky father deities able to usurp the mysteries of the divine mother. A trinity of huge carved stone goddesses representing the three main cycles of the moon and dating from between 13,000 and 11,000 BC was found in France in a cave at the Abru du Roc Aux Sorciers at Angelsuit, Angling. This motif continued right through to the triple goddess of the Celts, reflecting the lunar cycles as maiden, mother and crone, and image that also appeared throughout the classical world. By the late 20th century in the USA, witchcraft had been recognized as a valid religion by the American Supreme Court and accepted by the American Army, but other countries, including the UK, are not so tolerant. What is more, in many lands, especially among smaller communities, misunderstanding and prejudice still persist. In the UK, for example, Wiccans who practice openly and have children are sometimes regarded with suspicion by some health professionals. Therefore, witches were considered to have powers by which they could heal the people in times of distress. There are various tools related to the activity of witchcraft. Magic was traditionally carried out with the equipment of the home. The broom for sweeping the magical circle was the besom used for sweeping dirt and negativity out of the door and was stored with its bristle upward to protect the home. The cauldron was the iron cooking pot on the black kitchen range that served to heat the home as well as for cooking. Items often can be gathered from around your home, for example, a silver bale, a crystal bowl, or a large wine glass. Attractive scarves or throws make ideal altar clothes. It is suggested to keep the magical tool separate from other everyday household equipment in a large box or chest so that one can keep them charged with positive energies for magical and healing work. Fresh herbs have more immediate energies than dried. All these equipments were believed to be of age by which healing was imparted to the people of the society. I would again like to quote from the work of Cassandra Eason that magic is of different types in the society. Each society found their own way of doing magic, as they believed their own unique way of magic can bring healing to the people in the society. The different types of magic are sympathetic magic. This involves performing a ritual that imitates what you would desire in an outer world, so bringing on to the material plane a desire or need or wish from the inner or thought plane. This is done using appropriate tools and symbols. So in a spell, for the gradual increase of money, for example, you might grow a pot of basil seedlings and light a green candle. Contagious magic. This involves transferring and absorbing power directly from a creature or an object such as an animal, a bird, crystal, a metal, the wax of an empowered candle, or even the earth itself. This principle is central to the potency of talismans and amulets. For example, traditionally hunters might wear the pelt of a lion to bring them the beast courage and ferocity. Folk magic and ritual magic. Preliminary methods of magic in the society were known as folk magic. Folk magic was common during the 19th century. In the rural sector, the things which were generally used in home and gardens were the tools of folk magic. Herbal brews were created by folk magicians to heal, cough and cold. These were also used to induce love and affection among people for employment and for other healing activities. Ritual magic, on the other hand, involved rituals by which magic was carried out in the society. Attracting magic. It is a combination of both sympathetic and contagious magic to bring those results which are desired by the individuals. Banishing and protective magic. It strives to drive away all the negativity from one's life or a place. Binding magic. This type of magic helps to bind people in love or to bind the people in the society from doing any harm to others. Many a times, binding a thread in one's arm is believed to ward off all the evils and to heal the person. Black magic. This type of magic is performed to initiate harm for another individual or a community as a whole. These are done secretly without the knowledge of other people in the society. White magic. This type of magic is carried out keeping in mind about someone's welfare or for the good of the community. It is not performed secretly. Thus, the different types of magic are various ways to bring about healing of the members in the society. There are various tools which are used by people to carry out magic in the society. The various types of tools involved are: an altar is simply a special area for magic. They may be ornately carved, beautifully crafted works of art. They may be any specially consecrated tabletop on which you work when preparing spells and on which you keep many of the tools that you use. Amulets are used to protect the spell caster from any evil influences that may be about. According to Pliny, the first century Roman author, the amulet is an object that protects a person from trouble. They can be man-made, such as a horseshoe or a piece of jewelry decorated with a precious stone, or made from a metal that corresponds to the wearer's astrological sign, or naturally occurring, such as a rabbit's foot, a seashell or a stone, again with astrological correspondence to the wearer. The ethem is a double-edged ritual knife about 6 inches long. It is usually blunt because the only thing it is used to cut is energy. In accordance with tradition, ethems are black-handled. Wiccans and other spell weavers use the ethem to direct energy and to open and close the doorway to the spellcaster's circle. Baskets are used for keeping together and for carrying into the circle many of the things needed in spell making. Bath salts and oils are usually added to a ritual bath taken before starting to weave spells to put the spell caster in a suitably relaxed frame of mind. A bell is often rung at the beginning of the ritual when calling the four quarters, and at the end to tell the elements to return to their realms after they have been thanked for their attendance at the ritual. The bowline is the knife traditionally used by witches. It normally has a white handle and a curved blade. It is used to cut plants and herbs, vans and the other thing that needs to be cut as part of making magic. The Book of Shadows, also known as a grimoire, is the journal in which witches keep a record of the spells they cast, chants and invocations they use, the dreams they dream, and other matters that are pertinent to their personal magic making. Candles are absolutely necessary. It is almost impossible to make magic without one. They are used in literally thousands of spells. Efficient makers of magic ensure that they have a large store of them in all sizes and appropriate colors. Other magical tools that are used while doing magic in order to bring about healing of an individual are as caldron chalices, charcoal censers, compasses, cords, crystals, essential oils, herbs, incense stick, pens, pentagram, talisman, as well as a wand. Thus, all these tools of magic are essentially used by a magician when their followers seek for healing from the magicians. There are numerous rituals that are involved for healing of an individual in the society. The makers of magic look to the East for inspiration and believe that there are 7 energy centers that lie from head to toe of an individual. The colors and the energy associated with it in the 7 chakras in the human body are as follows. The chakra near the spine is the base chakra, which is concerned with the prime physical needs such as food and shelter. The color associated with this is red. The sacral chakra is associated with the color orange and is believed to deal with sex and emotions of the people. The chakra in the solar plexus helps to make decision and take responsibility. It is associated with the color of yellow, which encourages creativity. The chakra in the heart controls the emotional of love and is associated with the color green. The 5th chakra is the throat, which helps people to communicate their feelings with one another. It is associated with the color blue. The chakras between the eyes and the head are associated with the color indigo. The last chakra, known as the crown chakra, is at the top of the head, which is associated with the color white. These are a few rituals which magicians follow in order to act as a healer in the society. They visualize the chakras in the human body which needs healing and then works accordingly, by which they can cure the people from their mental and physical pathological conditions. The stages involved in the process of magic are as follows. The focus. This defines the purpose of the ritual or spell and is generally represented either by a symbol or the declaration of intent. Concentration is the key to this first stage. The action. This is the stage where you use actions to endow the symbol with magical energies. This is part of the continuous process of translating your magical thoughts and words from the first stage, the inner plan, to manifestation as the impetus for success or fulfillment in the everyday world. Movement is the key to this stage. Raising the power. This is the most powerful part of the magic, as the magical energies are amplified and the power of the ritual carries you along joyously. Growth is the key to this stage. Release of power. When you release the power in the final stage, you may see the cone exploding and cascading as colored stars or light beams which surge away into the cosmos and break into brilliant rainbow colors. Release is the key at this stage. These are the four different stages by which magicians does their rituals involved to bring about healing of their followers in the society. Comparative study of Indo-European texts and cultures suggests that the Proto-Indo-Europeans thought of medicine as consisting of three basic types: healing by magic spells, healing by surgery, and healing with plants and other medicines. These types align with the three major cultural functions that are typical of Indo-European cultures: rulership, war, and fertility. The three functions are reflected in everything from deities, as gods of law and magic, war and fertility, to social classes, and it seems that they appear in approaches to medicine as well. Plants were used medicinally by the Roman era and the post-Roman Germanic peoples, but they were carried out as amulets. A few Anglo-Saxon burials include amulets of wood fibers or bark, or seeds worn as beads. Others include small boxes that may have held herbs. The magicians use the herbs as medical drugs for the followers who come to them to heal from their pathologies. For instance, cannabis sativa can be used for its fiber, oil, and is thus used as a medicine. Various herbs such as henbane, hound's tongue, as well as hemlock are used by the magicians to provide healing to their followers. Agrimony is considered as a popular drug for healing the digestive system of the people, cuts, bruises, as well as throat problem. Allspice is a herb of healing which is used to heal rheumatism and neuralgia. Aloe vera heals wounds, burns and heals problem related to menstruation. Angelica is a herb which is used to heal people when they suffer from plague. It also improves circulatory and respiratory system. Thus, the various herbs and plants are used for healing by the magicians in the society. Therefore, it can be concluded by saying that the magicians involve themselves in rituals and claims to heal the people by somehow following the scientific line of action. The various herbs and plants along with the other natural elements are used by them for healing their followers in the society. Many a times the aura of the magicians and the spells used by them make their followers believe in their capacity for healing their pathology, but it must be considered that various rituals involved for carrying out magic and witchcraft in the society are indeed helpful in a multiple number of cases where incidents of being healed are reported. Thank you.